region where these things are happening to take a close look at what is really going on in the place. We were here in January 2019 to alert the United States government about the things that are happening in the place. And then if you look at the pictures, we begin with the theme of my presentation, ungoverned spaces as a breeding ground for global terror. Focus on Nigeria, the Lake Chad region, and the Gulf of Guinea. Let's look at this. The map you see there is the map of the global terror machinery, the global Islamic Caliphate, the ones who went to Syria and Iraq trying to establish their base for what they will do with the rest of the world. The other here is the Nigeria, the portion in green with the arrows pointing is the part of Nigeria they already have established control over. I'm sure we all know about Boko Haram. The Boko Haram is the West African franchise of the ISIS. And what is going on now is that while they were being challenged in the Middle East, they relocated through the ungoverned spaces that run from Somalia through parts of Sudan into Chad, and you know, they are just relocating to West Africa. All of those spaces in red, let's see whether we come to something else. Now, all of the places in red, you can see that Nigeria is lifted out of that hole. And they are in the portion titled Sharia Territory up there. And their eyes are on the entire West African sub-region, and they're already operating in the name of ISIS West African. You know, I'm sure we'll remember in 2015 when they exchanged, when Boko Haram exchanged a flag with ISIS, allegiances. So where we are is that unless something happens to stop them where they are, unless something happens to stop them from taking down Nigeria, there's nothing standing between them and the rest of West Africa. Between Chad and Niger and northern Mali that they had occupied before, they only need to overrun the rest of Nigeria as they're trying to overrun now to establish that caliphate they've been trying to establish. And the moment we get to that, the global community will pay in blood to be able to get them out. And therefore, what we had come to do in this closer examination of what the situation is and what to be done is to present the global community, particularly the United States, with a plan of what could be done to stop them. And that plan is like doctors do with the patient. You have your diagnosis, you have your prescription, then you have your treatment. It is ungoverned spaces that provide the breeding ground for them to begin at all. And therefore, you have to find out how to get to reverse the question of ungoverned spaces. What is it that has provided that kind of environment? If you probe, you will see that it's a matter of the failure of the regime of rule of law. The kind of things happening in those Borno and Lobe and all those places that it will not happen in any society that is governed. If you go one further step, you will be asking, why would there be failure of the regime of rule of law on this scale and magnitude? Again, you come to the very question of the constitutional arrangement in the area. In all the places where there are conflicts, you discover that it's just a matter of constitutional arrangements that are not holding. If you probe further, just like somebody who had to take care of who had to arrest malaria, you come from the fever you see to the mosquito that comes to bite, to the egg of the mosquito that must be reproduced for mosquito to come after 3 weeks, then to the pond where the mosquito, you know, has to lay that egg. If you don't trace it all the way to being able to prevent, remove the pond so that there's no egg that can be laid, so that mosquito, you are all over mosquito and all over malaria again. So what we have come to share with those who may be the destination for the terror that is being brewed across that sub-region, that the global community, what we have come to share is what it is that can remove the source of that ungoverned space from the location they are holding right now. And it is the constitutional arrangement of Nigeria that has put them in a position to do what they're doing in Nigeria. If the owners, the indigenous nationalities of Nigeria are united, and that's where my organization comes in. I'm secretary to an organization called Lower Niger Congress that has been in the vanguard of organizing those indigenous nationalities to identify who the enemy is and what can be done to stop the enemy from overrunning them. And in doing so, also reaching, as we look at the map over there, you see the Lower Niger, the eastern half of southern Nigeria. You see the other western half, the Yoruba space, and the middle belt where all the Benue and the Plateau, all the places that they're currently overrunning from where they already control up there. And you can see that it's a majority. The owners of the land in the white spaces you see in those three blocks have been organized to reject the constitution imposed on them by elements from the part that is overrunning the rest. And it is within the reach of the United States as of today to work with that with that diagnosis, to come to where that constitution that is already rejected by the rest of the union, because they say they insist that the constitution is made by the rest of us, say we the people. And we've come to where each of these three blocks had gone forth to repudiate, to say we didn't make. The whole world knew how we came to become one country by British colonial enterprise. And all of what became the Nigeria became one country on account of a certain level of autonomy that must be for each region. And all of that got abandoned in the mid-60s. What they have now is an imposition from that caliphate. And the rest of the people have rejected that imposition. It only takes those who want to stop them from being able to do what they're doing, coming in to stop them so that we can go back to working out what can restore the regime of rule of law in that territory. Otherwise, failing to do that is just giving an endorsement to this behemoth to grow full, this monster, to develop in full and come after the rest of the global community. And I think it is avoidable. Thank you very much.
Tony has helped us to understand the foundation for the crisis that is lingering in Nigeria as being based on a constitution that does not bring the people together. So, the next guest speaker is the Right Honorable Tiwase Obunde, who is the Chief of Staff to the Benue State Governor. So he came all the way from Nigeria for this purpose, because Benue State lies in the Middle Belt of Nigeria, and the Middle Belt of Nigeria has been the prime target of these nomadic invaders. So I will let Honorable Tuwase, come to the podium now and help us deal with the topic that is before you. Thank you.
Good afternoon, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and co-discussants. Let me first of all thank the LiftUp Foundation, LiftUpNow Foundation leadership for giving me this opportunity to say a few words. I'm asked to make comments on
a view to taking over people's land and making it their own lands, indigenous communities across board. And if anybody was in doubt, you will want to rely on the judgment of the former chief of defense staff for Nigeria, General Danjuma, who identified who was doing this, and then a former president of Nigeria who identified their motive, General Basanjo. What we expect the U.S. to do right now, that's the way the question reads, what do we expect U.S. government to do right now? There are three things we wrote out here, and I'll take them just as they were written. One, with the complete collapse of the four farmers, herdsmen, clashes narrative, sequel to the June 5-11, 2019 IRF roundtables at the Capitol Hill, having established the direct connection between ungoverned spaces and global terrorism with Nigeria in focus, having also established the causative factors to include the failure of the rule of law as the centrality of imposed and bitterly disputed sustained constitution of Nigeria to the failed regime of rule of law. That is the reason why rule of law has failed, is what you have to resolve to restore any kind of rule of law in those ungoverned spaces, that is to solve the problem there. Therefore, it is within the reach of the United States government to deploy existing policy strategies to proactively contain this direct threat to its national security, which may begin with a clearly worded resolution of the United States Congress articulating the findings of these roundtables. The roundtable has established that it is ethnic cleansing that is going on for the purpose of taking over the territory. So even a resolution from the Senate will send the message to the people who are playing the pranks that they've been found out, meaning that there will be consequences to attach. It can no longer be that accidents are happening and everybody's running around in circles. That's one thing that can be done. Second, in view of the urgency of the challenges of the adversarial trans-border migrants, the U.S. government need to move quickly to appoint a special U.S. envoy for Nigeria and the Lake Chad region to immediately rally the resources required to apply the quarantine plan to checkmate the dreadful terrorist nest that Nigeria's Sharia territory has become. The special envoy's mandate should encompass a swift easing out of the bitterly disputed 1999 constitution. We've been talking about the appointment of special envoy for quite a while. And I think the last thing is to look at now that all the sides of the matter have been examined, there are the people who are in that threat in the place, and they've organized themselves like you saw during the presentation. The rest of Nigeria are together in rejecting that constitutional arrangement that is enabling